we are actually dealing with a lot of different type of application, music, sometimes dance. And so it's a lot of different user and a lot of different public and a lot of different artists or collaboration. And that's really part of all our projects. So that's why I think we need to take into account these different type of interaction we have. It could be collaborators, user, public, and it's not really well defined, but we need to really try to understand that. And the methodologies to actually create or invent or use various tools and technology with a user are quite diverse. And what these two projects are interesting is that there is kind of an evolution of the methodologies. Classically, in human computer action, there have been all the really well-defined methodologies like user-centered design, where you really involve the user in the design of the product. But how you define user, especially when we're dealing with artistic object. There is also this idea of participatory design, and Benjamin is going to talk about meta design. So there are a lot of different type of design to involve the different people and actors. But so in human computer interaction, we talk about different type of user, like novices, expert user, power user, or extreme user, as Wendy McKay are referring. And for example, some artists are considered as extreme user. And of all that can be actually discussed. But more interestingly, and I think that we have this idea of doing more and more research action, which has been developed in sociology decades ago, and it's starting to reappear, where we really think that actually the research we are doing, we need to really take action and promote some interesting things. I'm talking really badly about that, but I know Sarah is going to explain that better than me. There is also this idea of ethnography or autoethnography, and also can we report our research as a first-person perspective, which is when you take more the classic scientific approach, usually it's not a first-person perspective because we want to be general and be not imply with the, to have an observer point of view. So all these things is that all these type of methodology call for different epistemologies, and I put with a question mark because that's something need, I think, to be rethink or discuss more and more the type of epistemologies we're actually using in this art, science, technology research. It's not a new debate, but that's a debate that's constantly evolving. So to finish my introduction, so I said one way to think about this interaction between different artists, scientists, technologists, you can also see that simply actors, and when I say actors, I'm referring to the actor network theory of Latour, where actors are actually something very general, could be human and non-human, so it's also the object that created, we interact with it. And it's really the interaction between all these elements that are important. So maybe the figure is not the best figure for that theory, because probably the best way would be to illustrate all the interaction between all these things. And that's somehow my view, and I think we agree, actor network theory is not a new theory. I'm not saying it's the only one or it's the best one, but just to put that shifting somehow the perspective of what we are doing to maybe going away from the more simplest things about just art, science, and technology field. So today we are going to talk about the living archive, so really more dance, and tomorrow more music with distributed musical things. But as an introduction, Sarah is going to give very short introduction, and Benjamin after, and after we will continue the day.
I think it's the other way around. Benjamin first, yeah. And then Sarah for the intro.
Yeah, that's totally correct. So we will start with Benjamin with music.
Hi. I will just present briefly the project just to have a taste of that. So it's an ANR project that just started in January, so it's the first year. So the result won't be the same as with Sarah. So the context is really experimental music and art practices. As Frederic said, we are in the intersection of several fields. So it's HCI, computer, sound and music computing, ubiquitous computing, but maybe we should stop that. And design and art, and I just—it's just an attempt, and it to put it in some kind of history. I think the Acousmonium is kind of an interesting point where you have all these different speakers that have each their own color, and you have to play with something that is not transparent actually, and multiple source, and then all this history and the two on the left, on the right, a project that have been done at Ircam once Greenfield in a previous ANR project, and an installation that has been made with the composer Jean-Luc Hervé that was in the Centre Pompidou, which is Biotope, where the speaker were hidden in the wall of the place,
the exhibition.
So just to have a bit of terminology, when we speak of collective interaction, we're speaking of three type of interaction. Interaction between computer and human, or between computers and computer, and human mediated by computer. What we do is generally collocated, so it's really kind of traditional performance setup in always everything in the same place. We don't use the internet or things like that, even if we use web technologies. And which is maybe more interesting from the computer interaction point of view is that I like this citation, and is that the distributed system is a collection of autonomous agents that appear to the user as a coherent system. And it's quite difficult to do that, actually. So the general goal is of the project is to support appropriation by practitioners, so and expert practitioners, so composers, music producers, RIM, like we speak at Ircam, or designers, so people that are expert in their own domain and may have some skill in programming, but it's not their main skill actually, so they have to be able to interact with this system, so some parts must be hidden because they are too complex or not relevant to their own practice. And what we try to do is to create this kind of feedback loop between creating the ecosystem, give it to the user, and try to understand how they use what is important for them, and feedback this knowledge into the creation of the system. So the challenge is So yeah, we are in artistic practices, so it's completely weird to we don't know what people will do actually, because very often they don't know what they will do. So it can really trial and error processes. You have to be able to have very rapid loops of trial and errors and stuff like that. And from a technological perspective, that's the idea of creating something that appears coherent, even though it's completely distributed on maybe dozens of hundreds of devices. So we are mixing all these disciplines, and just to explain a bit the meta design approach, the idea is to just, as I said, it creates some, they call it seeds, a kind of technological component that we give to people, understand how they appropriate these small components and build on top of that within a loop of development and usage. And that's it for me.
Okay. Okay, so thank you for being here. So today there will be a series of presentations about the Living Archive Project, interactive documentation of dance heritage, the experimentations that we've done, the collaborations that we had with practitioners, dancers, digital artists, and so on. And I think it's great that Frederic has really introduced what is common between these projects and the questions that we'll be asking today and tomorrow, which is not exactly about what we've done, but mainly about how we've done it and how we built these collaborations and what type of relationships we had with collaborators or actors, as Frederic said, the methods, the epistemologies that are underlying, and maybe provoke a little bit what is possible to be done, and critique some of it, and maybe think about perspectives for this field that is actually a collection of many fields, as Frederic was saying. So Living Archive, built upon basically many years of trying to integrate, or experiments integrating technologies in dance, and dance production, dance learning, but mostly dance documentation and archiving. So thinking about ways in which technology can intervene to write, trace, document, preserve, and transmit dance knowledge. And of course, it didn't came from a void. It came from a history and a lineage of these kind of experimentation, dating back to the 60s with the Nine Evenings events, for example, where engineers were already collaborating with dancers and musicians to create these kind of performances, where technology was seen as a medium for expression on stage. Most of you must know probably Life Forms, and I would say this is one of the most notorious kind of collaboration between researchers in HCI and computer graphics, and the choreographer Merce Cunningham, to create a software that could be used in his rehearsal space and studio. And the idea here was to basically generate choreographic materials and that informed in the shape of an agent that would be able to do all kinds of movements, dance movements and sequences that then Merce Cunningham would use with his dancer to create sequences of dance and choreograph movement. And in here we can ask the question again of what type of collaboration was drawn between these people, and who was benefiting from that, and who initiated this kind of project, etc. I actually happened to have done my postdoc with Tekla Shiphorse, who was one of the researchers who created Life Forms back then. And it seems to me that there was this kind of symbiotic, as, at least from what she tells me, a little bit more what would be thought of as participatory design now, although it wasn't exactly described as such. But they were spending a lot of time in the studio with Merce Cunningham in New York City, trying out the software. She told me about months where she'd take her kid with her, and then these kind of massive suitcases where the computers were stored, etc. And then she would set it up and just try it out and be debugging on the fly with Merce Cunningham, kind of giving feedback and so on. But things back then were very experimental, and I'd say I didn't find at least written testimony of how that was done. This is just kind of Tekla really telling me about her experience of that. Improvisation technologies is another example of that. And we also know Chris Ziegler, who was involved in this project as well. So these are all just kind of rumors and you know, people telling us how these kind of historic projects happened or were developed. Improvisation technologies was an experimentation where they built this kind of augmented CD-ROM, where videos of William Forsythe would be augmented with a graphical element that would show the choreographic knowledge that went into the William Forsythe's technique. So for example, a lot of architectural elements were added onto the image to show how he thought about movement in space, and how movement was basically moving these elements, was about moving these elements in space. Another project of whom we also know the researcher behind, Nora Zuniga-Shawn, who created Synchronous Object with William Forsythe. And this time, the idea was to generate, again, these augmentation onto image to show the cues that were used by the choreographer to create relationship between dancers in time and space. And from talking to Nora, it seems like she had spent hours and hours interviewing dancers to understand exactly the timing in which one dancer would give a cue to another dancer, and that would, and that's how they generated manually all of this kind of information to be added graphically onto the image. It's really interesting how these project kind of fostered back in the days a community of both researchers, technologists / technologists, and choreographers who were interested in technology as a way to explicit the knowledge that underlying dance practice. Motion Bank by our collaborators, Scott De La Junta and his colleague. Again, similar project, taking collaboration with notorious choreographers to visualize the elements that are underlying their practice and provide a way for the audience and dancers in general to access this kind of knowledge online. And then lastly, Double Skin, Double Mind, to which both Frederic and myself have participated. That's back then during my PhD, actually, in 2009, 2010. And here, it's an installation where we collaborated with the choreographers Emilio Greco and Peter Scholten, and mostly, actually, one of the dancers and close collaborator of Emilio Greco, Berta Bermudez, as well as other colleagues from linguistic, dance notation, technologist Chris Ziegler, who was a digital artist back then. So it's basically a group, a large group of people who were meeting on a regular basis throughout, I wouldn't even know, 5 years of time, 4 or 5 years of time, yeah, something like yeah. that. To articulate what was underlying or the underlying principle of Emilio Greco's training called Double Skin, Double Mind, and then start thinking about the different ways in which we could represent that knowledge with words for the linguistics notation, for the notation
for the dance notators, and for us with these kind of interactive visual and sonic representations of movement that we'd give to the dancers so that they could train with it and acquire the embodied knowledge of the choreographers. And back then, again, I didn't have necessarily the kind of tools or words to describe the methods we were really doing. It was quite participatory. Actually, the knowledge that came from these choreographers was at the center of what we were trying to build. I also went and trained with the company a bunch of times, which was extremely interesting, but also very painful because the company had this extremely strenuous methods that they would use to get to the qualities of what Emil Greco wanted. And so it was really based on the connoisseurship of the artists, and that built the knowledge by which we would design these elements. If I were to rewrite it again, of course, I would write the PhD in a completely different way. But anyways, it was a very interesting starting point for me. So kind of 10 years later, I started thinking about Living Archive and wrote this project. And one of the premises of the project is that no matter all of these experimentations that we've done, it was still difficult to come with ways in which we can document and archive dance knowledge. And the other premise of the project was that most of what the literature had was based on these big projects that I showed that created one instance of possibility of linking technology with dance archiving. And it was still a process that was very much unknown from the mainstream dance or the dance studios in general. So I wanted to see how I could work with different kind of communities, some of which were not necessarily famous major companies, some of which were very established artists, etc., and see how the methods could be applied from one field work to another field work. The other goal was to design kind of accessible and flexible and adaptable or appropriable interactive systems that would allow the practitioners to document their own dance knowledge from their own perspective, so from within, avoiding ways in which the researcher could impose their own views, their own biases, and their own desires or even intentions or goals onto the artists. So to create kind of a first-person method there, to create technology that could be used in a way that the researcher could disappear a little bit. I was interested in action research as well as a method that was beyond user-centered design. As I had spent a lot of time in a human-computer interaction lab, a lot of the methods that were developed were really centered around users, which is good and interesting, except that in most cases, the users are seen as inputs for generating ideas and output for evaluating the outcome in design. But all what happens in between is somehow the researcher kind of thinking and inventing these technologies and the users not being necessarily actors, as you said, in the whole process. Action research was also for me a way to put the research to further the engagement of the research in real world with long-term field studies, so not just interviewing people and then testing out the outcome, but really engaging with people throughout long-term commitment with their practice at the center of it. So it includes co-participants as active co-producers of concepts, technologies, and knowledge. Here is the slide that's absolutely unreadable. this is just to give some of the kind of principles behind action research there. So unlike, for example, what we know of user-centered design, it's not about developing best solutions to a problem, but it's really about gaining an understanding of the practice through, as I said, deep and long-term engagement in field work. and it relies on collaborative actions as a means of developing such knowledge. It requires the academic partners to recognize their roles, their biases, and influence, to situate themselves in the process rather than taking this third-person perspective that's of an objective observers outside of that process, really recognizing how your presence and your action are guiding that process in a way, which is undeniable. It focuses on, and that's really important for me, rather than developing general solutions for general problems, but on developing local solutions for local contexts. It does not privilege generalization, but it privileges really kind of exemplifying our methods. And this is something that's still really controversial in science, as we know it right now, so it's still an ongoing kind of discourse or debate. It focuses on developing scientific knowledge and supporting partners' need, using design artifacts as a means rather than an end on themselves. And again, as we said, it involves academics and partners as co-investigators, co-participants, co-subjects, co-designing interventions that provoke change for them, with them, and not for them. So that's a really big difference with user-centered design. It's with and not for. Yes, so these are some of the underlying principles that you'll get to see today through the presentations. First-person perspective, embracing indeterminacy and speculation, and following action research beyond user-centered design. I think that's it for me as a kind of an underlying presentation of the principles of the project. We will be presenting, again, different examples of all the projects that we've been doing, and opening the floor to questions, interventions, provocation from the audience members as we go. So don't hesitate to participate as you wish. Should we open to questions now?
Yes, we can, because I think we have
10 more
time.
Minutes. Yeah.
So if you have any reaction or question or comments, you're welcome.
Please be open, because we are recording.
Yes.
So, good morning. Thanks for this intro. And thanks also for pointing in those new directions that I think become more and more relevant, which is really this perspective from within, the first person. What I'm really interested in, as you know, is, you know, how do we go from practice to knowledge without breaking the link of the practice? Mm-hmm. And I'm really curious to see what you present of the, you know, the progress you've done in the last couple of years. And then one comment which I haven't seen really mentioned, but I saw in your intro kind of paper, is that you talk of artistic research and now you talk of action research.
Yeah.
I'm curious about the distinction.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. Is this question is for me?
For all of you.
All of us. Just to clarify, what do you mean by breaking the practice link? Or,
well, you mentioned already that traditional third-person perspectives take the practitioners as subjects.
Yeah.
Kind of in an almost extractivist way of getting out the knowledge.
Yeah.
And in artistic research, we strongly contest that the knowledge actually resides in the practice, and the big challenge is how to get it out of the practice without breaking that link, without going full extractivist.
Right, yeah. So in a way, I think that both your questions are linked, because you're also asking what's the difference between research action and artistic research. In Living Archive, both of these methods are used. I would say that it's, for me, I would place it between an autoethnographic process versus an ethnographic process. As artistic research, as such, is one where I would be taking on both roles as a researcher and an artist, versus an action research method, which would be still in collaboration with practitioners that are for whom this practice is their own. And you would see instantiation of both of these kind of methods in different projects that will be presented today. For example, there will be a presentation of the project with Lise Santoro and Pierre Godard, and that I would say is not exactly an artistic research for us, as this is really their practice, a piece in which we collaborated with them. Actually, John Sullivan, who is a postdoc with me, but the research was done from within, as John really participated in the production as such. So he didn't really just go there as an investigator taking notes. He took on the role of making from his own role as a technologist, if I'm taking back Fred's definition. I will also present another piece that's called Vintage, where I was both a choreographer and a researcher, and in there I really undertook kind of an autoethnographic process on myself. And that, I think, there is a different stance there.
Yeah, indeed. I think these perspectives intersect, but they're not identical.
Yeah.
And maybe as a provocation, I would just put out, what is the second person perspective in all of this?
Yeah. The second person, these are terms that I actually wrote about in my HDR. So the first person perspective, we all know about it, is the objective stance, observant, etc. I would say that UCD tries to be, or user-centered design tried to be, somewhere in between there, because it tries to empathize with the user, to understand the user from within, while keeping that kind of distance. It's just lowering it a little bit, but you're not completely involved. So in that sense, I think that the second person perspective is a way in which the researchers try to put themselves in the shoes of, while still maintaining their own role, glasses, lenses on. So you can see that a lot in certain kind of interviewing techniques. A lot of what we do as brainstorming, ideation, and so on, even participatory design in a way, is there. Yeah, I'm really interested in actually drawing the links between artistic research and research action. But I think artistic research takes on a little more freedom than research action. And it's still an ongoing also method that is being defined as we go, so.
Well, I have an impression that action research is a bit more for sure it's more general, because it could be also used in non-artistic field. I was wondering if you consider that someone who considers himself, herself, not artist, could do artistic research. Because
we need to open up the blinds for that
one. Artistic research is recherche création in French, just so that for those who are wondering.
And I'm even that's why actually that all the translation between English and French are really, really difficult.
Tricky.
Because I'm not sure it's exactly the same. And by the way, when I use the term technologist, that's something I wouldn't know how to translate that in French, for example, because I think it sounds like I'm using it in a very neutral way, like someone doing stuff, if I can say, doing things with technology. Doesn't mean he's pro technology or Mm-hmm. A scientist might do science without technology. Or different type of technology. But I think that it's quite important to make the difference between scientists and people using technology. It's really different things.
Any other questions?
Yeah, any other person?
Yeah.
I guess it's kind of the same question, but regarding the sentence you said, design with and not for, since it's about artists that have a really idiosyncratic practice, how can you, like, how do you not do, like, only custom-made tools that can't be reused elsewhere in other contexts? Or how can you extract what you did in other contexts? Do you even try to do that?
Not anymore.
Well, interestingly, I think that's what we're trying to do, and that we're going to be sure tomorrow that at least we are trying to do tools that could be used with different idiosyncratic usage of the things we are doing and trying to maintain. So that's part of...
If I can just add a little bit, it's kind of how to define something that is generic enough to be inserted into an idiosyncratic kind of setup. For example, a pencil.
Pencil
is any painter can use a pencil in a very idiosyncratic setup. There's no problem to that. It is just how to define something that can be appropriated. But it's not really an easy question. It's the problem of the boundary of the object you are making.
And also something I wonder myself is that when there is such a new tool that is developed with an artist, does another artist want to use it too? Because it becomes kind of his signature or her signature. Does it happen sometimes that those tools that were developed with an artist get appropriated by another one?
I think that's maybe why I gave. I think Max is kind of an interesting example because, of course, it hasn't been developed only with one artist at a time, but it was developed here in a very, very close environment. I wasn't there, so I don't know exactly, but. Then the software was really able to be generic enough so it could be appropriated to a large communities. But it took a lot of time because if you think that it started in the 80s, it has been went through a lot of complex history of commercialization that has been through several steps, PD, open source. Now it's 40 years. So it's a lot. I think it's a long process. But it's definitely possible, and it's it's super difficult, and most of the time we are failing. I think we have to acknowledge that as well.
And also, I think it's not it's something that you can think as a linear process. It's not linear. Actually, you will do something maybe very special for someone for a particular project, and some parts can be maybe generalized a bit, so you can reuse, and but that, yeah, that's kind of messy process.
Sometimes, and sometimes perhaps seeking for generalizability too much is, from the beginning, is a failure, leads to a failure. And we have a lot of examples in the literature, at least in dance, of assumptions that researchers make about what dance is, what it represents, what is a general way of kind of analyzing or dance movement, and then it just won't apply to everyone else. And so the literature has so many examples of, you know, kind of like gesticulating agents that would be dancing, but then a lot of people would say, but this is not representing the vocabulary or what I'm developing. And so I think that, and these are the places of tension, how much specific versus how much generalizable are the stuff that we create. And maybe sometimes the intention is to be specific, then it generalizes, and sometimes the intention is to be too general, and then it doesn't apply to any specific context. So I don't have really an answer for that, but it's definitely a place of tension.
And
I think that, sorry, just to finish, I think that a lot of what this scientific field asks for us is to generalize things. And I was just looking at a tweet lately where someone was doing research with Southern Hemisphere communities, and then they got their papers rejected because the reviewers were saying, but how does the outcome of this research applies to North America? And they're like, but it doesn't apply. And so it's not a problem. And so just to show that not everything can be generalizable necessarily, and sometimes we're faced with critique about lack of generalizability. And I think it's not necessarily always a value that we need to seek for.
I can just add something. There's also what is not in the product. When you create a system with someone, sometimes the important thing is what is not there and should have been, and you can see that it's just missing also. So that's really strange. You have to, that's why I think we want to work with people and understand how they work with things, because what may appear for us as, oh, you just have to do that, it's something that is really important for them. So.
Maybe we can move to the next session.
Okay.
I just want to say that at noon for lunch there will be some food and downstairs if you stay. And for the discussion with wine, there will be some wine at the end of the day. At 6 p.m. So we can keep the special discussion for them.
Okay, so it's still me. this next presentation is just to kind of introduce all the projects that we'll be talking about today and give an overview of the Living Archive and some of the key results that came out so far. So we're hitting the third year, I think. Almost done with the third year of the project, so there's only 1 year left, basically. So we're starting to see a little bit of a kind of a series of projects coming out, and I guess it will be my role to find links between them and to draw a story. So this is my attempt of drawing the story today. As I said, so this is a slide from my first PhD student, Mai Stjolfi, who already worked on documentation of dance processes. And she had interviewed choreographers, asking them, so how do you document your process while you're making it? And this is just an example of the diversity that one can see in dance, and how basically all the artists that we've talked to so far, they all invent their own ways of doing it. So some of them, you know, reappropriate Laban notation for Miriam Gorfing up there. Some of them use video, some of them draw, some of them invent their own symbols, and so on and so forth. So from this premise, the Living Archive project, as I said, had the goal of kind of exploring how interactive systems and technologies could be designed to be flexible and accessible, appropriable, adaptable, so that practitioners could document their own practice from their own first person. And as I said, it was grounded in action research because the goal was to seek long-term commitment to fieldwork and collaborators and to contribute both to knowledge and to benefit the communities. So these are some of the milestones work packages that we defined. One of them was to really understand how they did it by collaborating with them, talking to them, dancing with them, etc., to co-design these kind of interactive systems with them, to allow them to imagine how this documentation would work for them, to deploy it in real-world situation through this long-term field work. And lastly, which is something that we've done a little less of, to allow a larger public to access and experience these kind of dance repositories easily. And I'm going to introduce the first case study with someone you might see in here, which is Elisabeth. She's right there in the first row, and she'll be presenting later with Tove the collaboration that we built. So Elisabeth is a Isadora Duncan dancer. She had dedicated a big chunk of her career to studying Isadora Duncan, dancing Isadora Duncan, and also transmitting that knowledge to multiple types of dancers and generations of dancers. So let's see. So this was an excerpt of the portrait that Jérôme Bell did called Isadora Duncan, which Elisabeth interprets. She's actually dancing still with Jérôme Bell for his new piece called Danse non humaine. Is that correct? Yeah. Where there are also excerpts of Isadora Duncan's dances. So I started a collaboration with Elisabeth in 2019, I think. It was a year before the pandemic, and we applied together to a first grant that we had from the Centre National de la Danse about ideas around ways in which we could use technology to document the qualities of Isadora Duncan that Elisabeth was embodying. So the first thing that we've done, basically like a month before the first lockdown, is to do a motion capture or to run a motion capture session where we basically recorded Elisabeth dancing 8 different dances of Isadora Duncan, and also given classes about the different qualities of Duncan that are important. And Elisabeth will really introduce those qualities later with Tove and later with the presentation of Manon. And through this long-term collaboration with Elisabeth, I could introduce her to 3 of the students that were working with me in order to have different views and perspective of this vocabulary and try out, explore different ways of doing it. So first there was Vanilla Vilvanathan. We started looking at understanding first what was this vocabulary made of and what it represented for dancers. So we run, I think, a total of 5 different workshops with dancers that were training with Elisabeth. And I was also taking classes with Elisabeth at the time, so I could participate in these workshops. In these kind of body storming sessions, we'd teach the dancers, well, Elisabeth will teach them one of the dances, and then we'd bring material, sometimes different non-digital material, fur, things to draw with, etc. And after each time that we would perform, we'd ask the dancers to use that material to support the sensations of these qualities in their body and to represent it. And so we gathered a huge range of representations and drawings and body maps where they draw the different kind of quality sensations and so on of these dances. Later on, I also introduced my other PhD student, Manon Vialle, to Elisabeth. And Manon has also a background in dance and in computer graphics. She's now finishing her PhD in University of Grenoble. She really is in a lab of computer graphics. And you'll see a little bit the differences of perspective between her and what Tove has done of that collaboration. So through conversations with Elisabeth, trying out also to dance some of the dances of Duncan, there was this idea of creating this virtual ribbon that would embody in the way in which it moves the qualities of Duncan that we will explain to you a little bit later. So this is some of the... This is some of the steps that Manon has followed to create different versions of this virtual ribbon. So Manon has tried it out with the dancers through workshops, put that ribbon in virtual reality, augmented reality, done a bunch of experimentations, and drew kind of discussions and conclusions about how that ribbon supported the transmission of that vocabulary. And again, this is just to introduce that kind of work. Tove, who's also here, who will present her work, has also started a collaboration with Elisabeth, and she went on and did an autoethnographic study of Isadora Duncan because she started herself to learn the vocabulary of Duncan. So she participated in a company that Elisabeth formed with amateur but and also less amateur dancers, where she transmitted the vocabulary. Tove danced with them for 8 months in a row. That was how long the study was. But also she continued on with the collaboration and with the dance company. And from this autoethnographic study, research through practice study, using Soma design method, which she'll introduce to you, she built what she called the sonic scarves. And these are scarves that sonify the qualities of Duncan according to how she understood it through the process of learning it with Elisabeth. I'm not going to show this video because I think that Tove will show it. Okay, there were... So this was one of the biggest, I would say, field work that we've built upon. We also started a field work that Léo Chédin will present with voguing dancers. And that also consisted of running motion capture and then exploring more generative AI to see how we can generate basically movement that is based on the collection that we captured, so that they could re-embody themselves the ways in which we collected data on them or with them, and they could see how that inspired new movement for them, but also how that could represent a voguing style. Lastly, another case study that I've started myself and that I'm still working on is an ethnographic study of a dance based in the south of Morocco and the region of Guelmim. And in this study, I was interested in this dance called Gidra, which is a dance that's practiced there by everyone, basically. And it's a traditional dance where women are on their knees dancing, while men, a group of men, are dancing, just clapping on their hands and singing poetry in Arabic, basically. And I was looking at this dance because, first of all, it's a dance that's going slightly extinct in Morocco, as it's a form that's no longer danced by younger generations for many reasons. And I was looking at it also from the perspective of this dance being mainly a rural dance that's danced in villages, and because of different type of reasons that are beyond us, mainly global warming, the fact that a lot of the people who lived in the villages have moved around in big cities and didn't transmit the dance to younger generation. I was looking at understanding the context in which this dance is still practiced or not practiced at all. So far what I've done was to basically spend time with people, drink a lot of tea, have conversations, try to understand what they're doing and how come new generation of dancers are not so interested in this dance anymore. So I was so far not necessarily interested in introducing any technology or having any kind of intervention in this context, more so just to see and understand and learn also this dance myself, then see what to be done with them, have a bunch of ideas. Yeah, so there are many other things that we're trying out and there are still ongoing processes. John is working on a system for self-documentation. He's done interviews with choreographers mainly to understand again what tools they use, what's lacking, and so on. And most of what he came up with through these interviews was that people are using a lot of videos, but these videos remain used more on a personal level to remind yourself of what you're doing. And they're sometimes distributed among collaborators, but not necessarily used really as documentation unless it's done really on in an official way. So his idea, John's idea, was to see if he could design something that's very simple, that's just allowing you to go from video to motion capture and from motion capture to video, and to be able to kind of edit what you're recording to represent different information that are valuable for your vocabulary. This is a video of Lise Santoro, who'll be talking later this afternoon with Pierre Godard, trying out the system. This is the representation that she's recording on her computer. So yeah, here the idea is again to have things that are accessible and reusable. So this is a web application that one can access with their own computer, and they just can use the camera on the computer to record themselves and then edit their recording and access an additional information than video. Yeah, I think I'm running out of time. So there are other projects that have been started, one of which is within the Masters of David Lee. And here is an archive of female dancers kind of representing their career trajectory, visualizing that in 2D, 3D, as well as representations of relationship between them at various moments of their career. So I'm going to stop here, because I want to kind of open up for questions and possible links to be made. But basically, I think what the outcomes of this, or what I'm trying to draw here in Living Archive, is instead of having one singular output, I'm trying to draw on the plurality of the possibilities that we've been creating throughout these different projects that we built, whether it be Living Archive, or whether it be the collaboration with Lise and Pierre, or whether it be the Isadora Duncan project, and so on. It's each project has drawn us to basically think of technology in a different way, use appropriate methods in the collaboration that we drew, but all based on long-term commitments and kind of collaborations that we nurtured and maintained throughout time to understand really in depth what these practices are and to see how we can basically contribute to knowledge by design and interactive systems with the practitioners that we collaborate with or from within these practices. So yeah, I think that there's still some work to be done in order to basically drew these connections and relationships, but that's ongoing as well. So thank you, and then I'll take any questions or any comments or provocations you have about what I just presented.
Maybe I can ask a question.
Yeah,
when you say it contributes to knowledge in human-computer interaction, you said that somehow the system is not the contribution. So where is the knowledge from? You think it is now?
I would say it really depends, because, for example, in the case of Manon, the system itself is innovative in terms of computer graphics and how how I'll show later in the presentation, because Manon is finishing her PhD, she couldn't be here with us, but how the difficulty basically in representing the qualities of Isadora Duncan in kind of a virtual object. So that there is also sometimes technical contributions. They're all almost, but they're not at the focus, meaning that we're not trying too hard to make technical contributions there. For example, with the system that John is developing currently, that's just using state-of-the-art, you know, AI that's turning a video into motion capture data. I don't think we could publish anything based on that. But I think what's interesting is to really think about how that system, how can we imagine it, and what's the limitation of this type of system according to the different practices of people that we're trying it with. So this is where things get a little more juicy, I would say. And then I feel like a lot of what I'm contributing right now in HCI is to say that the problem is more complicated than than what is ideally imagined in the lab, and that there is much more to it that comes from really just trying out what you know how to do it and then failing at it and then iterating on it. So yes, in that sense, I think that's a little bit the overall message. Yeah, so I think it really is a one by one. And that's why I'm trying to say that in Living Archive, I think what was important for me was to have the freedom of exploring these different possibilities and having a plurality of approaches, of methods, of even stances. So, for example, Tove has taken really the stance of an autoethnographic project versus John is a different stance as well. And so I think that what's common to all of them is the engagement with fieldwork and commitment to understanding from within. But the ways in which we've been doing it has been very different from one project to another. And we took that kind of freedom.
Hi. I was thinking that Isadora Duncan didn't want it to record herself.
Yeah.
So how can you think of using technologies to record after, sorry for my English, but you know, to continue work with technology?
That's
after
a great question. I want Elisabeth to answer this question. Why are we recording and Duncan didn't want to be recorded? By the way,
My English is very bad. It's not the same question for her. I mean, as a dancer, she died in 1927. Nowadays, to know a dance, you know, as a part of history, you know, so this is, it's like you will say, oh, Mozart doesn't want to his music to be played when he's dead. No, I mean, I'm glad we can hear Mozart nowadays, you see. So I think it's important to know a choreographer, to know the dance of a choreographer, you know. Did you understand me?
Yeah.
So, and then it's with Isadora Duncan, she wanted once to be recorded. In fact, Station, it was a photographer well known at that period, and he was supposed to film her in Athens Acropole, but she said no, stop. I prefer to be remembered as a legend. So that's, you see, well, she was complicated too, I guess. So this is just part of how to know. I mean, the project is how to, how can, it's just knowing her dance, sharing a dance, and try to understand more deeply what the dance style is about. You see?
Mm. Yeah, and another, I guess, more simple answer as well is that she also thought that 25 frame per second didn't carry the continuity of the movement, but here we're using 100 frames per second. So.
Exactly, yeah. And then she did transmit her dances to different students, and it's how the repertory has been transmitted to me in New York. So the question is that, like for any choreographer, transmission is it's a very important question, you know. It's because dance is, of course, there are notation, but it's the art that's the most ephemeral in a way, you know, more music you have, but music a big corpus of notation. And then you go to museum, you see painting, and you can read book, you can read books and piece of theater. But as for dance, how do you know it if it's not in American they say reenacted, you know, reenacting, or how you incarne in French, we say, comment tu incarnes à nouveau cette danse. So it's the only way to nowadays to know, you know, as long as you know, in history, in dance, the as I said, the body, the dancing body, start to belong to history very quickly. In fact, Dominique Bagouet, for example, do people know Dominique Bagouet? He died in 1919, something like 1990. Mm-hmm. So now it's part of history. If people don't see his dance, I mean, he's dead, completely more than dead, you know. People don't know anymore Dominique Bagouet. So as long as transmitting the dance is really the only way for dance to be known. Mm-hmm. So the problem is even more crucial for dancers, for any art.
That's a great
sense. Please, I would send you another copy of Moment Musical. I don't like this version at all. I hate it. So I have a better one.
Okay.
Don't choose it anymore.
That's a great actual transition to, I think, Tove and Elisabeth are next, so let's do that.
Thank you. So we'll continue talking about some of what Sarah has started presenting. It will mostly be me talking about this project now, but I will talk a lot about how we work together, Elisabeth and I, and you are welcome to ask questions specifically to her afterwards. So I'm Tove Grimstad Bang. I'm doing my PhD with Sarah, and I'll present this work that Sarah mentioned from before that was presented earlier this year at the CHI conference. And then I'll go on to a continuation of the same work that we are wrapping up now. So in 2021, when I started working with Sarah, she introduced me to Elisabeth. And I'll just maybe let you introduce yourself. If there is anything more to add?
No.
No, you got an introduction from before. Yeah. But one thing I wanted to add is that you're a third generation Duncan dancer, which is something that's part of this transmission mode that you talked about just before. We'll skip the video. But Isadora Duncan, she's somewhat of a mythical figure in dance, and she broke with the rigid codes of classical ballet at the time. In the Duncan dance community, they are quite strict about the oral transmission, that this is something that needs to be transmitted from one generation to the next, and parts of the community clearly discourage using video alone as a means of learning the dance. So the three of us, Sarah, Elisabeth and I, started a collaboration around the transmission of the Duncan repertoire. And as a way for me, as one of the designers in the collaboration, to get close to both the qualities of the repertoire, but also the way that Elisabeth is transmitting it, I joined the company, like Sarah was mentioning before. This work then goes into a period of 8 months where I was dancing with the company, and we were exchanging on how to work around the transmission. We were entering this open-ended co-design process that was grounded in our collaborative practice in the company and our shared embodied understanding of the Duncan dance repertoire. And we used a soma design approach to sensitize our body to the repertoire and together articulated experiential qualities that we use to guide our design work. This use of experiential qualities that are slowly articulated through practice, that's one of the main main parts of the Soma design method. So in this process, our dance practice, conversations between Elisabeth and I, and prototyping were intertwined, informing and inspiring one another. And in the dance studio with the company, Elisabeth focused on transmitting the movement qualities that were central to the repertoire, for example, fluidity that we saw a bit of, or quite important earlier, which if some of you are interested, I'm sure you can add two more afterwards. And then along the rehearsals in the studio, we regularly met up for discussions. And here, in our conversations about the dance, music became a shared language between Elisabeth and I. And in addition to the really tight music-movement relationship in the repertoire itself, and Elisabeth's way of transmitting it, where you use a lot of dynamics and temporality of movement, you also sometimes vocalize movement qualities or movements during rehearsals, which all resonated a whole lot with me. And you use musical metaphors or other metaphors to, in terms to describe these movement qualities in words to the students. Yeah, this all resonated with me coming from a musical background, and it really helped me understand the dance and what my teacher was looking for in teaching this these qualities. So this is what led us to sketch out an initial design idea that was related to movement sonification, and the idea of sonifying scarves, since scarves were already part of our practice. That I think you could vaguely see in some of the pictures before, and the one Sarah saw, it was part of as props of some of the choreographies, but also in the whole image of Isadora Duncan. She uses scarves a whole lot in her dancing. So as we progressed in our dance practice and conversations and slowly started prototyping our sounding scarves, we reached an articulation of an experiential quality central to the to Duncan's work. It's one of the qualities that really stood out and helped me in our collaboration, which is connection to the ground. And that involves perpetual transformations of anchoring, lightness, continuity, and fluidity. So following iterations on our initial design idea, we finally designed and built two silk scarves embedded with temporal sensors and two different sound designs for movement sonification. So one of the sound designs with ocean sounds reflects the experiential quality through mapping with a strong sense of gravity and a lingering effect. So here you see Max MSP on the left, and how the incoming sensor data is mapped to CatArt, whose creator is here, and a corpus-based concatenative synthesis that takes grains of our audio, the ocean sounds, and spreads it out across this 2D space based on different acoustic descriptors. This is the other sound design with the voice, whispers, and keywords from Isadora Duncan's own writings as a metaphor of creating a dialogue with the past. So this one is reflecting the experiential quality through a mapping with a sense of continuity and the perpetual transformations of the sound with movement. So we then shared the probes with six dancers from our dance community and observed how the sounding scarves brought a new dimension to sound and movement in the dance practice. The scarves really made the movement qualities palpable to the dancers in a new way, as it was emphasizing the rhythmic qualities and the movement propagation and continuity, as one of the dancers illustrated in a body map here. We also observed how the lines between the beginning of sound and the ending of movement and vice versa were blurred. And next, we saw one group of dancers having a profound experience with sound and movement, as one of the dancers illustrated in their body map here to the left. This experience was facilitated a whole lot by Elisabeth, who encouraged them to be attentive to the sound and to each other, while another group had a very different experience here of feeling detached from the sound and struggling to find variety in their movements. So in the case of the ocean sounds in particular, we reached a complex correspondence between movement and sound through a mapping that combine immediacy, synchronization, but also the lack of it, which for some of the dancers made a really rich experience, while for others it made the scarves really challenging to interact with. And for Elisabeth, this correspondence allowed the dancers to hear the after effect that you evoked as we were dancing with the scarves, which is an important notion in Duncan's work and relates to the propagation of the impulse of the movement. You don't start a movement and then it ends abruptly, it always continues on. The experience of correspondence here created an active dialogue between the dancers' movements and the sound. And the transmission of Isadora Duncan's dance knowledge, like we discussed a bit before, is built upon a fragile tradition that relies on a small number of people and that the knowledge continues being transmitted across down across generations. And with this work, we wanted the technology to emphasize embodied knowledge, and instead of using technology for preservation or replication, as maybe is more of the approach where you record a large corpus of videos. We propose a design approach here that integrates the technology while staying true to this transmission mode. And also the second sound design we named Murmurs from the Past, and that was created as a direct metaphor of constructing a dialogue between past and present. And this whole design process continued within the tradition of the Duncan repertoire being transmitted across generations. Finally, in our collaboration, the time spent together really made space for humility, slowness, and careful listening between all of us. And my own sensitivities to the Duncan repertoire have transformed a whole lot during this work. And as I became a part of a dance community that I'm now in, it's made it much clearer for me what's at stake when we as technologists, or maybe scientists, or artists, with multiple hats at the same time, go in and engage with the community and a creative stage, and whether we actually facilitate the ongoing practice or if we intervene in potentially harmful ways. So the focus on valuing existing knowledge is central here. So rather than taking on interventionist strategies where you design systems to support where maybe no one even asked for support, we aim to develop on how design can be one of the means to dialogue between practices and between actors, to share knowledge and to ask questions. I think I'm running a bit short on time, but I'll go quickly over some of the work that also came out of this. It's a second branch of the work where also Fred is involved and one PhD candidate from NSAD Lab. So over the same 8-month period, I was recording my movements during the dance rehearsals in the studio using an IMU, the same IMU as in the Sonified Scarves. And this was with the inertial measurement unit. It was synchronized with audio and video. I had one sensor on my wrist and another at the on the chest, the solar plexus, which are both important. We ended up on choosing these two places in conversation with the research team. And the initial intention of recording my movement was to keep a trace of the same dance routine or the same choreographies for each rehearsal over a longer period of time, thinking that maybe we would be able to see a change in the data as I progressed in my learning. So now we were sitting on a huge data set of quantitative data together with the qualitative data that was a big part of the previous work that I discussed. And we went on to analyze the data with the purpose of partly a probe into my learning progression, but also to serve a data-driven design process to physicalize this data for introspection and continued learning and as a means to communicate and share the trace of my learning experience. So in the same way as the musical metaphors were a gateway into understanding the subjective experience of learning the Duncan style in the work previously presented, physicalizing the data here is opening a gateway into the intangible aspects of my dance learning experience. So the process of physicalizing the data consisted of first analyzing the data, then encoding it into 3D models, and fabrication of artifacts with the data. So in the data analysis, we started by processing the raw IMU data and visually mapped each choreography with the graphs in two dimensions, like here it's over time, accelerometer data, of one of the choreographies from my wrist with the, this is from first day to last day over the 8-month period from top to bottom. And we saw clear patterns appearing in the raw data already, like the sort of different phases of movement, you can see here, which follows or reflects the pattern of the choreography as well that goes in an A-B formation. So we decided to narrow down and focus on only one choreography for this design work, which you can see a short excerpt of us dancing here. So for the final data set and the physicalization of our artifacts, it all comes from the accelerometer data from my wrist, from the choreography Dubinushka that you can see here. A short part. I'll move on since we're short on time. And we tried multiple approaches of encoding different types of both raw and processed data. Like here it's low-pass filter data, accelerometer data from the same as before, across the height of the cylinder. This is the same data in a different shape. This is a distribution plot of the same data, but for multiple recordings in one cylinder. And then we ran multiple attempts of 3D printing these models with clay, like the distribution data that collapsed on the upper right there. So eventually, with a bunch of failure with the clay printing, we went on with the distribution data that you can see here. It's stacked distribution in two dimensions, which gave us a sort of average representations of all of the recordings grouped by different intensities. So it's also here again from first recording to last recording over 8 months. Then by rotating the outline of the stacked plots, we got a series of profiles like this that we used to model cylinders. And it represents each cylinder and each model then represents a day or one recording. So these are the final models, the 3D models, with some adjustments to the inclination of the axis and the radius of each cylinder. And we 3D printed the models in PLA and created molds to make plastered artifacts that you can see here. So these are from the first recording, first day, and across 8 months to the end, coming from the distribution plot. I think I'll maybe speed through this. We then ran a sharing session where the research team met up to evoke some of the embodied experiences of learning the dances by interacting with the artifacts, which was led by Sarah doing an experience explicitation interview with me. Some of the things that really came out was the shape of the artifact and how it reflected some of my experiences of the learning. And then we also went on all together discussing the qualities of the artifacts, how they in themselves physicalize an embodied process that is otherwise quite hard to trace. It's in a way a trace and a documentation of the my subjective experience of learning the dance. And it's a poetic and a very ambiguous type of representation of the dance that gave a lot of room for reflection and discussion in between us, but maybe also for other discussions in the future. So this work will be presented in detail in an upcoming publication. Thank you for listening, and if you have questions for Elisabeth too, then feel free to ask
it for you too.
Yes. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for this run through, because it looks like a lot of work in described in a very short time. What I now find really interesting at the very end, and that's maybe also a question for Elisabeth, is so you were focusing on your learning process and looking for ways of somehow fixating it or capturing it or then also representing it. What I find interesting now at the very last stage of representation is that it becomes diffuse again, maybe similar to the ephemerality of the dance that you mentioned, and that this diffuseness carries maybe some of those qualities you were thinking about. So I'd be curious to hear, you know, this intangible aspect going through the whole data acquisition, data processing, filtering, etc., to reach again something that is soft or diffuse.
I could say from my perspective or from my side, this was such a, in a way it was very unintentional that we came back to this. It sort of all just led into what it became, and it was really only upon discussing this between the four of us and that we started seeing how this ambiguity really carried a lot of those qualities, and even the very specific qualities that were so important to me, like the grounding. You can clearly see that the object becomes more and more grounded. It has a larger base over time. But that was something that was not, it was not like in the at the forefront of the process. It was really a design process that was going back and forth between the learning I was continuing dancing with Elisabeth throughout the time where I was making these artifacts as well. Yeah, maybe you have something on the.
Peut-être préciser. Tu veux que je précise un peu les qualités d'un camp?
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
C'est là.
Yeah.
Alors. Maybe I should precise the quality of Duncan is what is specific in her. It is very specific in the dance world, the way a movement is constricted. Je sais pas comment dire. There's a center of movement that's very important for her. It's what you mentioned solar plexus. So it's, of course, center of gravity in the pelvis is here, you know. But she had another center of momentum and disequilibrium, of balance movement. It's very high in the body. It's solar plexus. That's why, and I think it's interesting because really you have this all on the all in your poetry, you know, you see you have the round accent on this. You understand the round, there is a band here qui reste toujours, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
Right, like it figure out the solar plexus. And then from the solar plexus, the energy is just flowing from towards the arm, the leg, the back. You know, everything is organized around that center. So, and then everything is fluidity. There is no form. There's not so much. Duncan, in the Duncan style, the space is not so much important as the time. So that's very important. It's not so much the space, the shape, the form. It's important. Not the form, the exact form. What's important in Duncan style is really the energy flowing outside, out from this center. This is what I, and then what we have been working on a piece, it was from Centre National de la Danse. I was working of transmitting a dance from 1921 when she was in Soviet Union. So this dance is very much grounded, you know, it's those dance almost like, I should say, agitprop, you know, it's like Varshavyanka, Dubinishka, it's those dance from really part of the Soviet history of agit propaganda, you know, very grounded dance. So that's why she's speaking a lot. Tove is speaking a lot of grounding, because those dance are not part from the so much light. They are not light. They are very much grounded and yes, about revolt, about you know, asserting, manifesting, you know. So this. So it's certain quality, those dance are this quality, yeah. I wanted to make the context of those dances by Duncan. It's that important. Mm. Two directions.
Maybe I would be interested in you, Elisabeth, actually saying what's in it for you?
Excuse me?
What's in it for you? What's the benefit of this process from the dance perspective, not from the design perspective? It's for you, Elisabeth. Qu'est-ce que toi, tu... Quelque part, qu'est-ce que tu en tires? Qu'est-ce que la danse en tire de ce processus-là?
Ah, le processus de Tove?
Oui, cette collaboration.
Bon, il y en a eu beaucoup avec toi. de ce pro... in English. First of all, I was very... I didn't know what Tove was doing in a... I didn't know what you were doing with your computer, with your whatever. You didn't tell me. You didn't just ask me if you could do. I said, put stuff like, and I said, yes, of course. But I didn't know what she was doing. You know, it was very mysterious, in fact. What I see, it's a dialogue between her own history, her own body history, own experience of that dance, you know, and that touched me, you know, the story, I mean, the experiment of Tove and how it comes to this kind of a artistic artifact touches me. What I find very interesting, too, is the relationship through the music, I mean, it's our common sensitiveness, the music, how she, one day she came at home and she brought those scarf with the sound. And I thought it was very much pertinent, how you say pertinent? Coherent, pertinent. Comment tu dis?
Coherent.
Hein?
Coherent.
Coherent, yeah. Et because the how she translates, I found interesting how she translates the quality of Duncan in sound, like a continuous sound that really are in fits with the dances of Duncan. This is no form, not, but it's just about continuity. So I found that interesting too, the way she Tove, and then one day she asked me to the words, to, well, to use the words. So I found that interesting, this the way she translates Duncan movement into sounds, you know, that time. And then I was so surprised with the with the poetry, you know, and I think it's for me, when I came to see you showed me that, I mean, I didn't understand exactly how she made those, but I like how each shape was different. I didn't understand what you this, you know, I mean, all the process. It was very mysterious, very sensitive, and it was your own almost secret in a way, you know? And I like that. I like that when the students have secrets and that. Yes, and because I give things, I give away what I've been receiving, and then I give away when I transmit, and I like that when they have true secrets that I don't understand. So, and, well.
I have the question about the sound, because you just talk about the continuity, because most of them, at least what I know, is that the Duncan dance is always with a specific piece of classical music. And is it for you that are something very different, this sound process, or is it somehow similar to the use of music?
Yeah.
How would you?
In the music, there's two things. There's a, like what Tove has been using, the wave sounds or classical music, you have continuity, but then you have change of force, you know, of energy, you know, pianissimo or you know, fortissimo. So you have like in a body, you find the correspondence, the analogy with the movement, it's to say force and lightness. So you have a dialogue between force and lightness and time, quickness of sustainment. You see what I mean? And so in Schubert music or Beethoven or whatever, I mean, when you Bach, when you listen to those music, you can too sense what's coming to the phrasing, in fact. Although there is no notes in the wave movement, in the wave sound, there is no, I mean, there are sounds, but no notes, let's say. So, but what's common, it's energy and time. That's what they share, you know. You see?
Yeah, but I mean, would you say it's kind of, I don't know the right term, but like somehow a simplified version or kind of compressed version of the music? Does it work the same way? Because you find the same type of, you can find the same similar phrasing with the sound and with the music. There are some similarities.
Yes, of course.
But it's much more, as you said.
Analogy, I would say analogy.
You would say analogy.
Oui, correspondence, analogy. But I mean, it can be in during the rehearsal, it was a way of for the dancer to be more sensitive to the phrasing, like of the voice, because it's two songs, you know, two Russian songs. So it was like the body could be more attuned with the phrasing of the voices. So the work with the scarf could make the dancer more sensitive to the phrasing.
Yes, one thing maybe I just quickly, like Elisabeth mentioned before, two of the three pieces that I was learning are vocal pieces, they're choral pieces. So it's quite a different Isadora Duncan than what you usually hear in one Chopin piece.
Oui.
Do we have still a bit of time? Thank you for this amazing presentation. I'm super interested into the how can we design with the experiential qualities, and how can you collaborate with this ambiguous embodied perception. And you talked about grounding a lot, and also these secrets. So is there like an ambiguous perception that can be shared, or
In this first project, where the experiential qualities were a big part of reaching the final design, I started out with some sort of perception of what I felt during the dance rehearsals, and it was only through going back to that in rehearsals and through discussions with Elisabeth that I started understanding it more intellectually, which sort of loops back with helping to understand it in an embodied way too. And it was then Elisabeth who helped me to really articulate it in a way that made sense for the design work too, that I could go back and see, does this movement with this sound reflect that part of the experience or not. So it's an ongoing process. Did you ask how to?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's one thing that was key for us here is that we had the time. We took the time and we exchanged on what was going on over time. I don't think it would have been possible to come out with the same results in a very short period of time, because especially my body needed the time to understand what was going on. Yeah, but that's a luxury maybe in research.
Maybe we continue?
Sure. Yeah.
Oops.
Hi again. So for this presentation, I'm simply filling in. This is the work of Manon Vialle for her PhD. She's currently finishing to write her thesis, so she couldn't be here with us today. I'll try to faithfully present the work, and Elisabeth will support me, I hope, in this presentation. So Manon has also started a collaboration since the beginning of her PhD, actually since her master thesis, with Elisabeth. Elisabeth and myself has visited her lab in Grenoble, started conversations around the meaning of Isadora Duncan, and so on. And from these conversations, she was interested in using computer graphics to visualize Isadora Duncan's movement qualities. And she was interested in three concepts that Elisabeth can probably explain. So, solar plexus.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Non quoi?
Le plexus solaire.
Solar plexus, yes.
The wave.
Ok. Tu veux que je traduise?
Si tu veux, après les films, tu peux expliquer les trois concepts.
Ok. Solar plexus. Oops.
And the third one? These are the three principles that Manon looked at in terms of her visualization. Maybe Elisabeth, you want to say something about these three principles?
As I mentioned before, solar plexus. Here, it's not a solar plexus. It's not a bones. It's not muscle. It's a plexus. So it's very nervous tissue, with nerves. So it's comment c'est de l'imaginaire quoi je veux dire c'est it's not scientific you know Duncan is not a scientific it's imaginaire you understand so for her this is the center of movement because the center of emotion for her and from that center she like this center will be full of energy and this energy is just propagating into the arms, the legs, the backs, and then even from outside it comes back to the center. You know, there's a conscious movement outward and inward, starting always from the solar plexus. It's very specific because it's Isadora Duncan. You don't find any modern dancer with such a motricity. And then the wave movement, because she really, for her, movement should be unending, like nature, like the world, like the flux of energy in space, you know. So the movement should really be continuous, with no end, no abruptness, yeah, no, yeah. So everything should be continuous, and it could be strong. You know, it's not necessarily mild and soft and stuff like that. It could be strong, but never stop. You know, so this way movement. So it's like even when you send a gesture like that, at the end there's a suspension, and you don't come back with the same. You don't come back through the same path. There will have always some kind of a loop, a suspension of time and lightness, a loop, and then you come. And here again a loop. And here everything is looping. So it's just the figure eight, the waves, everything is curved and dilating. And then so it gives this, what we said, fluidity of time, yeah. Fluidity, quality, fluidity, yeah.
So the first study that she's done was based on, again, co-designing an artifact with Elisabeth. So we run, again, this motion capture session. There were 64 markers that were put on Elisabeth, 6 different dances, 5 were recorded twice, and 100 frames per second, which gave us... And then multiple lessons that were given that were on these principles, which gave us 25 minutes of dance data that at some point we will try and make available for the community of dance and science community. Through the multiple iterations that she followed in designing this artifact, the first idea came from this idea of a ribbon. So providing an abstract visualization of the body that still followed in a way a shape that was kind of a head to arms, a tailbone, and the legs, but that didn't provide necessarily the realism of an actual human body, but that carried with it the dynamics and the qualities of Duncan, and precisely these three characteristics of the solar plexus, movement starting from the solar plexus, propagating through a wave in a fluid, endless, continuous matter. So these are the steps that she actually followed, and they were punctuated with discussions with Elisabeth, who looked at the model, gave feedback on the quality of that movement, and kind of fed into the process of designing it. So I already showed this video. This is without necessarily sound. Here you see this ribbon consists of two ribbons that are not necessarily attached, and you see little artifacts. Then the head is introduced. The ribbons are still two ribbons, kind of disjointed. Then we see the head becoming one ribbon, and then everything kind of connecting in the solar plexus upward. And the last version with a movement that's much more, I'd say, fluid in a way, right? So we started taking this model and bringing it back to the studio with a variety of dancers who were training or were introduced to Isadora Duncan by Elisabeth. A first workshop which we reported on with six dancers, they learned moment musical and danced with the projected video of this model. We run then questionnaires and group discussions and analyze the data with thematic analysis. And what came out of that was that the abstraction that we chose was actually perceived in a positive way by the dancers. They appreciated that the body was reduced to its elementary lines and elements. They felt like they were dancing with so-called natural body, natural as in the definition of Isadora Duncan's natural movement. One dancer said, "We really see the liquid, the fluidity, we really see it a lot. There's a big fluidity of the spine and an opening of the spine. There's this continuum." But a lot of them reported on the difficulties of dancing with a flat screen, as they couldn't see it or couldn't perceive it as they took on space. So the second workshop that we run... Oops. Manon took that ribbon and put it in an augmented reality headset with different controls that the dancers could do, basically slowing it down, speeding it up, taking space and looking at it from different perspectives, stopping it, replaying it, etc. And so we did another workshop with the dancers where we gave them these virtual reality headset, HoloLens, more particular, to be precise. And Elisabeth transmitted folatrie to them. And then again, we run questionnaires and group discussions and analyze the qualitative and quantitative data. And so here we can see a dancer with the headset. Ça, c'était Water Studies.
I think avant, there c'était Falletry, mais maintenant, c'est Water Studies, like cette lance-là.
Two workshops that collapsed into one.
Ouais.
So, yeah, the they still kind of experience the ribbon in the same way than they experienced it on the flat screens. They liked the perception of it. It sees the line, the curved line, the fluidity, etc. And the ripple, what they call the ripple, is basically this wave idea of the movement kind of starting somewhere and then moving towards the extremities of the body. But on the use of the augmented reality, there were a lot of glitches with using the virtual reality. None of them had ever used these kind of headsets in their lives, not even less so in the studio. So a lot of what we were observing during the workshop were just dancers trying really hard to push virtual buttons on a virtual interface that was uncanny for them. And then they really needed to get familiar with it, and that kind of came on the way of dancing and on the way of learning. But there was a lot of openness to how these kind of models and how these kind of experimentations could open up new ways of perceiving a different dancing body and how one can train with it. And how just the experimentation in its own right was an interesting attempt to safeguard or transmit the vocabulary in its own right. I think about the first study, the co-design, and really centering everything on the connoisseurship of Elisabeth, bringing things back and forth between the studio and the lab, was an attempt for us to value the vocabulary and the embodied knowledge above all, and to explore ways in which that knowledge can be visualized and given back to the dancers. So then Manon went on to a second study where she was inspired by a dance notation that is not as known as Laban or Benesh, and that's called Sutton notation. What's the name of Sutton? Is it Suzanne Sutton?
Oh, j'ai oublié. Sutton.
So this notation was inspiring because it really looked kind of like what they use in computer graphics. And it really relies on notating the shape of the body in space and relationship of that, kind of like keyframing movement. And so Manon, coming from computer graphics, when she was introduced to this notation, Sutton, especially one that was done for Isadora Duncan, I believe she found that, thought, what if we can actually design an artifact, a graphical artifact, that can also represent the spatial patterns that are taken by the dance and give that to dancers so that it supports their perception of speciality in their transmission. So here are some of the prototypes that she developed. I don't know if this is a... So she basically developed these tiny keyframes where the dancer feels like the body goes from one keyframe to another keyframe. As if there's like a feed forward of what's going to happen in the dance, and then the body's like embodying it. So there was, again, a lot of iterations with Elisabeth on this because sometimes it felt like it was confusing, sometimes it felt like there were too much information displayed. The solar plexus trajectory is also displayed in here, so you can see that trace. Then there's this red ribbon that's the performer's ribbon, and then there are these white little keyframe ribbons that are disposed in space and that the red ribbon is actually embodying as they go. So she ran a structured observation where she compared how the dancers observed or how the dancers reacted to different versions of that prototype, one where all the keyframes were displayed, another one where only the next keyframe was displayed, and the third one where you didn't see the red body and you only saw the three next keyframes, three future keyframes. Do you remember?
Oui. Yes. That's
good. And then we did a workshop again where we tested these out, and Elisabeth taught transmitted prelude,
oui.
Another dance. So which, what's nice with this project is that every time we do a workshop, I learn a new dance. So that's really, really fun. This time was prelude, each one of the dancers could experience each one of the prototypes and have some questionnaires again in group discussions, etc. And so here is one dancer who's basically actually improvising with the system here. See that there are so many different ways of doing this experiment, and the diversity of what we observe is really interesting. From someone that's just, sometimes the dancers were just standing and kind of looking at it and being like, oh, this is really interesting. Another dancer would improvise with it while it's not at all what we were asking them to do. We were asking them to kind of perform the dance, and she's like, oh, this is a great kind of co-performer, co-improviser. So it's really, it was interesting because we couldn't tell what was working better. We could just tell that everyone reappropriated it in very different ways. We also could see that there were obviously a lot of limitations of these kind of augmented reality headsets, as people didn't, like the dancers were not familiar with it. Sometimes they'd lose it. Or sometimes they wouldn't have the kind of spatial relationship with the avatar so that they could follow it around and so on. So there was a lot, it created a lot of confusions, but it also created a lot of kind of opportunities or new things that happened in the studio. So it's quite fascinating that to introduce this kind of like high-tech in this kind of context, because we gathered a lot of different relationship to it that we didn't actually perceive, or that we didn't really thought would happen at the end of the day. Again, this is a very different approach than the approach that was followed by Tove, for example, with the exact same vocabulary and the exact same transmission. And I think what's interesting here is to see how things are complementary and how they allow us to learn even more about Duncan and the vocabulary, but it also allow us to think about the space in which these technologies, whether the more embodied one or augmented or in virtual reality, can be introduced in these kind of contexts. And in both projects, I would say that we really saw the value of taking a long time to co-design and build knowledge and understand the process and participate in the process for both Elisabeth and for ourselves. So I think these are some of the conclusions that we have. When we wrote the papers about these experimentations, we thought that it was interesting to have a perspective that's both enthusiastic about the possibilities of these very high-tech stuff like AR and VR, but it's also critical about it because it's just technologies that are not necessarily designed for the studio. dance, and therefore they're extremely cumbersome and not necessarily that easy to bring in for dancers to practice with. So I thought that also this kind of discussion, what does it bring and what does it take off from the spontaneity of dancing, was an interesting discussion that was held by Manu as well. So I hope I did I didn't omit anything that Manon would speak about, but I think if you're interested, I think Elisabeth could give us also her perspective of collaborating with Manon and of
there was all
coming up with the ribbon.
Yeah, there was. I mean, the main problem for Manon as a mathematician is to translate Duncan gesture into algorithm. In fact, how she transferred to this elastic band. I mean, she made a lot of calculation. I admire. I mean, this mathematician. Work that she has been doing to transmit Duncan gesture into a soft ribbon. through those algorithms, how she gives the sense of elasticity in a ribbon. I mean, the animation for me that was very interesting and astonishing.
We can open for questions from the floor if anyone is.
I want to say one thing important is that when I work with Manon and Rémi Ronflin and you, it was I really make point to use as for when we talk about animation tool, how to translate in animation. I really said I will ask it should be. Ribbon or it should be tissue, because the imaginary of a Duncan dance, it's as body wise, it's really tissue. It's to say fascia, what we call fascia, it's tissue. That's why it's not bones, it's not muscle. You know, certain dance like Cunningham, I should say, it's much more, the imaginary, it's much more on bones. I mean, it's like, it's very découpé, I say, clear design and stuff. It's very articulated. And the dance of Duncan is not about articulation. It's really about continuous movement, fluidity, and that's why tissue, a foulard, well, this piece of material I wanted this kind of animation. That was the only animation that would fit with the imaginary of Duncan dancer.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes. So thanks for the presentation. I also do performance with a headset, but it always limits my movement. Like, of course, it gets hot easily and. If I move faster, like I get glocky, and also it can be removed, and also like I cannot roll on. And like I think the technology limits our movement, like in also daily life. Like when you use smartphone, everyone does same movement, and Face ID also like smart speaker, you need to speak like clearly and without dialect. So, like, I'm worried about, like, that technology, like, removes our detail. Also, like, in VR or AR, the calibration removes small movement. So, I'm worried about it. And also, like, as a dancer or as a performer, like, of course, it's not comfortable to do it. So, I wanted to ask about, how is it like dancing with a headset, and also how do you think that technology like limits our movement?
Yeah, I agree with you. But there was another question. I mean, Sarah was asking too how a student could be a dancer, could be could work on its own without you know, in a studio. So having, instead of seeing on the video, you know, on the screen, you have it on your holo set. And so there was a question how you can incorporate a dance through this object, you know. And then, so that was another way of learning. That was this question of another way of learning instead of watching a TV, and you know. And then I agree with you, it's not comfortable. I mean, if you bend, you may fall down, stuff like that, and back again. So, but I said to myself, well, it could be improved.
Technology, like, you know,
yeah, technology will be will improve. So, you know, that's why maybe lighter, another way. You
so
know,
now I we are just adjusting the current of technology. So if so, when the technology gets evolved,
I'm confident on that, you know, technology issue. But it was the question that Antara we ask ourselves is that how a dancer can be independent from, you know, the choreographer to learn a dance, and how the dancer could, with the HoloLens can be, can experience, how much this person can experience a dance through this is an HoloLens. That's what we were interested to. So there was, as you say, some people say, well, this is not comfortable and stuff like that, but some that we can still catch some, you know, movement of the dance, you know. Voilà.
This made me think of one thing. In how, on the second part of this work, you saw how people used the HoloLens in very different ways. For example, one dancer who really went into improvisation. Mm-hmm. But is it then experiencing Duncan's dance, or is it something else?
She was still improvising Duncan-like style. Not exactly the Duncan dances, but she was using, she was definitely moving in the Duncan's, you know, she was still embodying those qualities of Duncan, which was an interesting outcome for us, because we really thought that they would be following that red kind of ribbon, and she didn't see herself in the red ribbon, so she started taking it's as a partner and complementing it with her own version of the dance. So, and I think, yeah, I think that's what was interesting with this project, is not necessarily to say, is virtual or augmented reality good or bad, but it was mainly to say what, so if we give it to the dancers, what do they do with it?
Yeah.
What are the potentials or drawbacks?
Yeah.
Of it.
Yes, because we had one session too that they learned moment musical through the ribbon too. And that was very interesting how they catch many, many movements and quality from the ribbon animation. And they really speak about some abstraction of a movement, and they can catch movement from this abstraction. So that was interesting, this movement, this moment. How do we, can we learn from an abstract animation? Mm-hmm. Can we learn a dance? So that was it was interesting, this discussion, I think, with the dancer.
Any question? If not, I would say that we can first congratulate for this really inspiring morning, I think. And as I said, we have sandwiches, vegetarian downstairs, minus two, so please, and we can really continue the discussion all together. And then we continue this afternoon here at 2:30. Thank you.
Thank you.
At 2:00. 2:30.
Merci, Elisabeth.
Merci à toi. Merci à toi. Merci à toi. C'est toi qui as organisé toutes ces...